Why is Kansas City Congressman Emanuel Cleaver getting indigestion over a sandwich?
This is a Satan sandwich. There's no question about it.
But he's not the only one saying no to what's on the menu. The surprising ways your local members of Congress voted on the debt ceiling this week. Plus, why are some checking whether Missouri Governor Jay Nixon is still a Democrat? Also this week, putting Kansas City police officers back on foot patrols for the first time in 30 years. And 170 water main breaks in a month. Is it just the heat or a symptom of larger problems ahead? Hello, I'm Nick Haynes. Those stories and more coming up. Dissecting the week's headlines around the cozy confines of our Week in Review table this week from the Kansas City Call newspaper. Eric Wesson is with us. Kansas City Star City Hall reporter Lynn Horsley, the chief political reporter for NBC Action News, Chris Hernandez, and political analyst and Star multimedia reporter Dave Helling. Kansas City Congressman Emanuel Cleaver was getting a lot of national attention this week. He was pretty much on every TV network, it seemed, as he denounced in the most colorful of terms the contentious vote to raise the debt ceiling.
This is a Satan sandwich. There's no question about it, because there's nothing inside this sandwich that the major religions of the world will say deals with protection for the poor, the widows, the children. It's not in here.
Now, but for all his talk on the national networks about this being a sugar-coated Satan sandwich, why did Cleaver say later that if his vote had really been needed, he would have actually said yes, Eric Wesson?
Because morally, it would have been the right thing to do. The country was going through some economic issues if they hadn't have voted. It was the best deal on the table. You know, the Medicare, the Medicaid cut, Social Security was a moral thing. And a lot of Democrats are saying that it was the president that put that on the table and not the Republicans.
But all this colorful language, though, Dave Helling, for something he would have voted for if pushed?
Well, of course, anyone who's covered Congressman, Reverend, former Mayor Cleaver, as long as the people around this table, and certainly as long as I have, understands he has a penchant for colorful language and a penchant for drawing that kind of attention. I mean, one of his aides told me this week, it's the preacher in him, you know, he comes up with these images. I do think the debt ceiling issue itself illustrates the interesting split between the sort of middle, left, and right in American politics. When you have Emanuel Cleaver voting on the same side as Vicky Hartzler and Todd Akin, we are seeing the fringes of the political spectrum vote one way, and the really middle, in a large sense, voting for this ceiling increase.
Chris. Well, I think as far as Cleaver, it's classic Cleaver to get that turn of phrase that just solidifies an idea and really gets the attention. I mean, you remember back in the day when he killed light rail with one phrase by calling it frou-frou touristy stuff. And that's what he is able to do with the power of language. I do agree with Dave talking about these votes. You've got some people really sticking to their philosophical guns, you know, like Vicky Hartzler. I don't think her vote was a surprise. I think Todd Graves, we've talked about a little bit, you might have, Sam Graves, not his brother. you might have expected him to vote.
Let's put these votes on our screen here, because again, I jealously guard, if anybody knows me, the time we spend on this program to look at local issues, but to help us understand what seems like some of these head scratching decisions of our area members of our congressional delegation. In Kansas, we see here, Republican Kevin Yoda says no. In Missouri, as we're hearing Chris Hernandez talk about, conservative Republican Sam Graves says yes. Now, how come then?
Well, I think that has to do more with the fact that he recently was elevated to a leadership position. And once the GOP leadership got on board behind this, you kind of sort of have to fall in line with that. I think there would have been maybe some pushback from the leadership in his new leadership role.
And I'm sure there were people calling wanting to make sure they got their Social Security checks, too. And I'm sure that had a lot to do with a lot of the people that were on the fence with that, because but there was a crisis.
But it does seem odd, though. I mean, you have two Republicans who like to call themselves conservatives, just with one state line in between them, why they should be so different on this
very issue.
Well,
the deal didn't involve tax increases of any kind. And I think Sam Graves would be in favor of that. I think Claire McCaskill felt like if she didn't approve the increase in the debt ceiling, that was driving the economy off of a cliff. So every side had a gun to their heads. And I agree. I think Cleaver probably felt that if his vote were essential, he wouldn't have voted to drive the economy off the cliff. But since they already had the votes, he could take this stand on principle.
Let's put that screen back on. Can we do that? Thank you. What about the U.S. Senate then? In Missouri, Democrat Clem McCaskill then votes yes, as Lynn Horsley just pointed out. So does Republican Roy Blunt, a Republican, as we say. In Kansas, Pat Roberts votes yes, but Jerry Moran votes no. Anything we learn from that, Dave Helling?
Again, I do think that once it was clear in both houses, Nick, that the bill was going to pass, that the votes were there, there is a certain liberating sense for that for some members to sort of vote their consciences. And you get the sense that Jerry Moran wanted to send a message and he really didn't think it went far enough. Kevin Yoder said the same thing. Kevin Yoder, a freshman in the House, but not really considered one of the more Tea Party aggressive members of the freshman class, he voted no because I think he voted his conscience. So usually it's all Republicans versus Democrats. It was fascinating to see how this all broke down.
Eric.
I think that a lot of it has to do with the economy. They knew that their votes really didn't matter because they had them all, like David said earlier. So they could take a risk and maybe get some headlines and maybe get a moral point across to their constituents.
Now, while we try to understand the sort of political calculus of our area congressional delegation on the debt ceiling vote, some are questioning the political calculations of Missouri Governor Jay Nixon this week. Is he really a Democrat? A front-page story in the Kansas City Star takes a look at several of his recent political decisions, which have been raising eyebrows even among his supporters. Nixon just signed into law a measure that for the first time requires welfare recipients to undergo drug tests before receiving benefits. He has allowed to become law a bill letting Missouri ignore requirements of President Barack Obama's health care reform law. He also signed legislation lowering the minimum age to get a concealed gun permit. These do seem to be positions one would expect from a Republican governor than one would expect of a Democratic governor. Why?
Well, I think one thing you can look at is he's made it very clear he's going to govern from a very centrist viewpoint. And in a divided state like Missouri, where the Democratic Party and the Republican Party are always duking it out with very tight votes in many offices, it's almost something you have to do. And quite frankly, the liberal Democrats may complain about some of these recent things you've outlined, but where are they going to go? They're not going to, if they vote against him, I mean, are they really going to go vote for the Republican? Probably not. And if they stay home because they're mad at Nixon in the next election, they're not helping themselves because that probably means the Republican will win.
But forcing welfare recipients to undergo drug testing before receiving benefits, the governor could have allowed that to become law without his signature, those kinds of things happening. That didn't happen in that case. He could have done that.
Right. And probably that probably would have been the best thing to do. Taking a position like he took and actually signing the bill, I think will come back and haunt him later, especially with the Obamacare as well, signing that bill. Because in another year and a half, he's going to be riding Obama's coattail into the governor's mansion again, or trying to, with the voter turnout, especially in black communities in Kansas City and St. Louis. So I don't know if that was such a good idea.
Lynn.
I think Nixon is probably a conservative Democrat. When he was the attorney general and Kansas City was involved in its very expensive desegregation case, you had liberal Democrats wanting more money, and Jay Nixon was pushing back at almost every turn. He resisted the state contributions to the desegregation case. So I don't think this is a new trend for Jay Nixon. He's living up to the image he's had all along.
Yeah, the good news and bad news for Nixon, Nick. The good news is that he is clearly one of the most political governors that Missouri has seen in many, many years, and he's brilliant at it. He understands the politics of this state, which leans Republican, and yet he's the overwhelming 10 to 15 point favorite as we look at the race next year. So he understands that people pay attention to symbolic things like the health care compact law that really doesn't have a lot of effect, but people are paying attention to. So he's smart in that regard. But I will say this. If you talk to Democrats, they get a little frustrated that he's signing these bills, the abortion bill, Nashville, that type of thing. But mostly they get frustrated at Jay Nixon because Jay Nixon only cares about Jay Nixon. He doesn't really care about building the Democratic Party, making Democrats statewide more popular. He hardly lifted a finger to help Robin Carnahan in 2010 against Roy Blunt when some of his, that is Nixon's popularity, might have rubbed off on Carnahan. He stayed completely out of that race. He really sort of played both ends against the middle on redistricting. That's made some Democrats mad. So the bad news is that the party really is frustrated with him, the sort of lower level party members. The good news is he's almost a certain candidate for re-election because he understands the politics of the state and has executed it so far rather brilliantly.
It has been ungodly hot out there. Perhaps that might help explain why in Kansas City there were more than 170 water main breaks in July, nearly double that of last year. Kansas City, Missouri City manager Troy Schulte says it's a symptom of a much bigger problem, aging pipes that should have been replaced decades ago. Schulte says the city should be spending $55 million a year on new water pipes, but it's actually spending less than half that. With little money in the city coffers, the privately owned Missouri American Water Company has made overtures to council members to consider selling the water system. But is privatization in the works, Lynn Horsley?
I don't believe so. This idea surfaced a number of years ago when Kay Barnes was mayor, and it was quickly squashed by the local city unions. They resist any idea of privatizing the water system. You know, the water utility is separate from most of the rest of the city government. It's supported by rate payers, not by the general tax dollars. But it has been underfunded. I mean, they clearly have a big maintenance problem on their hands. I'm not sure they see privatization as the answer. If you look at what Missouri American Water has done in other communities, their rates are going up probably faster than the Kansas City rates. So the mayor has said he does not want to take on this battle right now. Now, that doesn't mean that they couldn't privatize certain operations, maybe a sewage plant or some aspect of the water system. But selling the entire water system, none of the politicians seem to be enthusiastic about that.
Chris. Yeah, and to play off what Lynn was saying, this idea of selling off just bits and pieces for private management, I mean, that did come up also during Funkhauser's administration. Didn't really go anywhere then, but it keeps resurfacing, and it is this idea that if you can, there's no way the entire system's gonna go, but if you just do this plant or this function or that function, it's sort of a way of bringing in that. I don't think there's the political will to get that done, especially in light of the fact that they're just launching this $2.5 billion sewer upgrade that they're required to do by the federal government. I think all of the issues related to that are sucking all the oxygen right now when it comes to water issues.
Dave. Yeah, the issue could get forced a little bit if a bidder, a private bidder, whether it's American Water, Missouri American Water, or some other company, makes a rather substantial cash offer for the utility. If they sort of went public and said, hey, we'll pay you $1 billion, which you hear sometimes, or more for the water system, and ratepayers in Kansas City are looking at the prospect of paying so much more, not only for the sewer, combined sewer settlement, Nick, but all the broken pipes. I mean, somebody's got to have to pay to repair those, and I think the council knows that. At that point, then the squeeze could start for council members who look at that kind of revenue and think that might be an easy way out. Whether it's enough to put them over the top is another question altogether, but it could make things a little uncomfortable.
I agree. It would be very tempting to get $1 billion and use that to quickly overhaul the system, but they've had examples of other cities that have sold off their systems and found out that didn't work for the long term, right, and have had to buy it back. And, you know, when you sell something, you lose control, and the politicians are loath to do that at this time.
It's one of these issues that is really important, yet you don't get paid much attention because you don't see it until you see the type
breaks
of video.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right.
We've had people without water in the last few weeks when it was beastly hot outside, and they certainly care, and they're angry.
But Nick, I mean, we talked about the debt ceiling earlier. You know, it isn't just water pipes. It's bridges, roads, schools, public facilities, swimming pools, water pipes, all have crumbled, continue to crumble, and the bill continues in Kansas City, as Lynn and Chris and Eric well know, it is increasing dramatically. I mean, every year they go, well, we should be putting in $50 million, we're only putting in $25 million. at some point, that, you know, that, to coin a phrase, that chicken's going to come home and roost pretty expensively for the people of Kansas City.
Eric.
And I think that taxpayers and people that are paying their water bill, they don't care. They just want their water, and they want somebody to do something about the water bill. So if somebody comes along with an idea that says, hey, we can fix this and lower your water bill, because when you get through with all those fees on your water bill, you're sitting there scratching your head like, how much am I actually paying? And people in the urban core are frustrated with their water bills and the service that they're getting from the water department. So if anybody can come in with an idea that's better, they'll go for it.
At least it makes the politics of it more complicated.
Yes,
well, the water rates were artificially low for a number of years. There was a period again during Kay Barnes' administration where they froze water rates for a few years, and they did not invest in the system. And now they're having to raise rates substantially every year, and probably will into the near future.
Lynn had a very good story in today's Star about the property tax problem.
Well, you're biased because you also work for this.
I'm sure
you're correct.
For those who have not taken your Kansas City Star, be sure and pick up a copy. But she talks about the increase in assessed values in Jackson County and how many homes have not been reappraised, reassessed for many, many years.
So, 25 years.
So property taxes are going to go up for those people, even though the overall levy may or may not go up. Water bills, the sewer settlement. I mean, you know, Kansas City has delayed some pretty difficult choices on very expensive things, almost to the point where they can't be delayed anymore. That's really the challenge, I think, for Sly James going forward, because when these bills, as Eric points out, start hitting mailboxes, property tax bills, the political calculus is going to get very, very dicey very quickly.
Well, one of those intractable problems that people get frustrated by is the issue of crime. But for the first time in more than 30 years, police officers are again walking the streets on regular foot patrols of Kansas City neighborhoods. 14 officers will operate from 11 a.m. to 3 a.m. Tuesdays through Saturday during this 90-day pilot program aimed at reducing crime in some of the city's toughest blocks. But what impact will it have on a frustratingly high crime rate? We'll talk about it in just a moment. But if you missed it, the story, here's how it was reported by NBC Action News.
Officer Drew Pittenger is getting some business cards and leaving his patrol car right where it is. He and his partner Ryan Taylor are heading out for a walk. You might call it old school policing.
Once upon a time, that's all officers did, was they walked a beat. And we got away from that when we started getting in the cars.
He's not suggesting giving up the cars. He says it's about reaping the benefits of getting out and about in a neighborhood.
We're trying to build the trust to where the community feels comfortable in coming to us with their problems.
Today, these officers went to the community.
You'll definitely see us around.
It's the first day of a new project at the KCPD. New officers start their careers doing a daily foot patrol. Pettinger and Taylor graduated from the police academy a couple of months ago. For the next 90 days, they'll walk the area around Armor and Troost.
To let you guys know that we're here.
This area was selected because of its rampant crime. 7 homicides, 74 aggravated assaults, and more than 100 robberies in a 3-year span. But there's hope. The foot patrol project is modeled after one in Philadelphia, where statistics show crime went down.
Them being out here today let us know that we should walk as a group.
Neighbors like this say the more people see the police, the more likely they are to work with them. These officers plan to be seen so they can solve problems before those problems result in crime.
The reporter Eric Schultz of NBC Action News. Eric Wesson, how is the program, though, being perceived?
Can I do a shameless plug?
I wrote a story this week about crime. Available on newsstands now, ladies and gentlemen.
Right. Hey, you might as well.
Absolutely.
But I think that the major problem that they're going to have is, one, it's only 90 days. How much can you do, or how much connection can you do with the community in 90 days? And two, what's the safety net for the other communities and surrounding areas? If you run them out of one area, they're going to go someplace else, and you don't have a safety net there, then your crime moves from East Patrol to South Patrol. And I think that that's the biggest problem that people have, and it's not going to do the end result that they think it's going to do, because they're out there for 90 days. People are going to start calling the hotlines and working with, how you doing, officer such and such. I don't think that's going to be the result.
But they are pairing them with UMKC researchers who will be tracking perceptions in those areas and looking at similar zip codes and neighborhoods to those to see how the perceptions are different in those, so they can see if they want to continue the program after that, if there is any perceptible difference.
Well, I think if they want it to work, they have to continue it, because that's the biggest problem with any of these new and innovative programs that we're going to do to fix everything. But then they don't stick with it. And that's true of the police. It's true of the things in the city hall. It's, you have to stick with something to make it work. I mean, 90 days, like you said, or any lesser period, just doesn't give it time to actually happen. Now, please.
And let me add this as well. The problem in the inner city, we have black males killing black males. And everybody knows that, but we don't want to really talk about it. You have to change the way these young guys are thinking. You can put police out there day and night, and they can be friendly with everybody, and they can do this, that, and the other. But unless you change the way that these young guys are thinking, you have to try another approach, because that's not going to work. You just move your problem from one point to the next. And you have to take some innovative approaches to how you deal with crime in the urban core in Kansas City.
And I think this week we should also point out that for the first time, Mayor Sly James went to a murder scene as the police were there dealing with it at that moment. He happened to be nearby. He heard about it. It was in the middle of the afternoon, and he went. I have learned since then that he has actually gone along with police for some other things, just for a chance to get out in the field and talk to
officers.
Well,
this is just perfect, Chris, because let me show you this story here, and we can comment upon this then, because I have this story here, because there has been concern about how little is being done about crime. On the news blog, Tony's KC, there's this headline: Mayor and City Hall silent on homicide despite an escalating homicide rate. Sadly, local politicos are more interested in developer giveaways, urban chickens, Google, plaza condos, and fundraising. Meanwhile, Kansas City continues to kill itself. Where's the mayor on crime? Is the mayor absent on the crime issue? Now, could this, though, be the result of that story that the mayor is doing these things
I
now,
think,
though?
I think it's highly possible.
Correlation here?
Given the timing.
Absolutely. Okay.
Absolutely. Now, one thing that I was told when I sort of raised a question close to that was that the mayor had not been to a murder scene, but that he had been quietly going along with officers to just on other things, just to get a sense of what they're doing. Now, going to the murder scene right after this is on the blog.
Yes, yeah. But in fairness, though, how much does the mayor of Kansas City and the city council have control over the crime issue,
well,
though,
they
Lynn Horsley?
Really, except as far as economic development and keeping creating jobs and working on education and some of these longer-term things that Eric says are the real solution to the crime. He is on the police board, and
yes,
I think he's been very engaged on the police board. He says one of his priorities is to get an excellent new police chief, which is the next big assignment for the police department. You know, again, we've talked about this before. Kansas City is one of two cities in the country that is not directly under the management of the city government. It's a state board. So the governance of the police department is also important. I think Sly talked a lot about crime, addressing crime when he ran for mayor. I think it is one of his priorities. It's one of multiple priorities. It's also a very intractable problem, and it's not going to be solved by foot patrols or, you know, a single strategy. It's going to require a broad brush.
And throw in a quick editorial. It's not going to be solved by blog posts either, because it's one of the easiest things in the world to say we shouldn't pay more attention to crime. Of course we should. But paying attention to it doesn't solve it by itself. It takes investment. It takes buy-in from police officials. Sometimes they resist change, like most institutions do. It takes a buy-in by politicians. And Eric's exactly right. It takes some change in the culture, particularly with young African-American males. And that, as I suggest, will not be solved simply because somehow we're paying, quote-unquote, more attention to it. It's a good gesture from the mayor, but it doesn't really get at the root cause of what's going on.
Eric.
What's the plan? We can talk about it, but what's the plan? What's A, B, C, and D? Economic development, EDC, that's a great concept, but who's going to put their business or who's going to want to move into an area where you have people killing each other or shooting each other? The first quarter of the year, there were 450 assaults in the Kansas City metropolitan area, the majority of them in East Patrol and Central Patrol. Who wants to put a business there? Who wants to put a grocery store there? If you put one there, who's going to go shop there because they're afraid somebody's going to snatch their purse or their groceries? You have to deal with this crime before you can do anything in this city.
And that's a great point, Eric, because economic development, jobs, I mean, that's if you have a job and feel that there is economic opportunity for you, you're going to be less likely to turn to crime as a way to make a living or just because you think that's the only way to deal with life.
But the crime isn't coming from that. The crime is coming from I step on your shoe, you get mad, pull out a gun and shoot me. It doesn't matter whether I have a job or not. Those are the things, it's the way they're thinking. Everything begins with a thought.
You know, I have to say, when we talk about, we've heard a lot of, in the last couple of weeks about the local control over the police department in St. Louis and Kansas City, the only police departments in the country not under local control. Would the mayor have more control over the crime issue if you do have local control over the police department? Would the mayor have more say?
I would say it in another way, because it would depend a little bit on how it's structured and how, you know, the governance is handled. But he would certainly have more responsibility for crime.
Okay.
You could blame him more for it and other elected officials if there's a crime problem. Right now, the answer from elected officials, Nick, is it's not our responsibility. We don't even control the department. That's why it's important to change.
And that is our weekend review. Our thanks to our news reviewers from the Kansas City Star, Lynn Horsley and Dave Helling, from NBC Action News, Chris Hernandez, and from the Call newspaper reporter, Eric Wesson. I'm Nick Haynes from all of us here at KCPT. Thanks for spending part of your weekend with us.